Yute is a Kayapo Indian chief from central Brazil. Today, he's traveled from his own village on the edge of the Amazon forest to this mining town on a special mission. Yute is here to visit his bank manager. Gold has been found on Kayapo land, and Yute is today checking a village account which gets some $2 million a year from Brazilian miners.
É o seguinte, você tem uma movimentação muito boa aqui conosco?
Sim.
O senhor vai sacar algum dinheiro?
Não. Na sexta-feira a gente chega.
Deep in the vast Amazon rainforest, 500 miles to the southwest on the Xingu River, live another group of Kayapo Indians. They oppose the mining of gold. Their leader, Chief Ropney, is on the radio. To Chief Ropney, Kayapo land is untouchable. Using radio to cover the vast distances, Ropney lectures his brother Kayapo about allowing Brazilian gold prospectors onto their land. Some 2,000 Kayapo Indians live scattered in Brazil's Amazon rainforest. Their aggressive attitude towards other Indians and Brazilian settlers makes them the most feared tribe of the region. Half the Kayapo live on traditional land in the Goritiri Reserve, where gold was recently found. In return for some of the revenue, they allow Brazilian miners onto their land. 500 miles away, on the Xingu River in the village of Capote, live Chief Ropney's group of Kayapo, who oppose this policy. 340 of these Kayapo live completely isolated in the traditional circular village of Capote. Our story starts with this group and the debate they're having about the gold miners. But today, the village is almost empty. A great ceremonial hunt lasting a month is taking place away in the forest, and Chief Ropney is taking his family downriver to join the hunters. For traditional leaders like Ropney, this is one of the most important events of the year. Terry Turner, professor of anthropology at the University of Chicago, has known the tribe for 25 years.
I've known Ropney since I first began working with the people of Capote. All his life, he's had to fight off Brazilian incursions into his people's land. Some 50 Brazilians have died in the skirmishes he's fought over the years. He's also an intelligent political leader and diplomat. It was he who persuaded the Brazilian authorities to grant his people the legal title to the land bordering this stretch of the Xingu River.
Ropney flaunts his martial exploits by using a motorboat captured from Brazilians unwise enough to come onto his Kayapo land.
The Kayapo relationship to their land is central to their culture. It is supremely expressed in ceremonial hunting expeditions, which Ropney and his people undertake several times a year, and which last for several weeks.
A great hunting camp has been constructed deep in the forest away from the river. It's a temporary village of some 250 Kayapo from Capote, which will move every 2 days when the game is exhausted.
Look on your map.
The way this hunting camp is organized shows why the Kayapo are such a potent political force. Both the men and women are divided into different age groups, which work collectively in highly organized teams. It's a system based on seniority, with the older men, the heads of households who do the hunting, at the top.
It's now early morning, and the senior men like Ropeni, in their important hunting role, leave as a group for the shoot.
Next in the pecking order are the young bachelor youths. They also work together as a group, clearing the trail to the next day's campsite, a distance of 1 or 2 miles. As a group, they too must follow the directions of the senior huntsman above them. The younger boys also work as a team, cutting wooden racks to hold the large tortoises brought in by the hunters. Once again, they're subservient to the older youths and the men above them. Adult women working in teams build the houses of each new camp. They cut firewood, cook the food, and transport most of the family possessions between camps. Younger unmarried girls work together carrying water and tending the children. The whole system functions smoothly and automatically as a support network for the senior men and their prestigious role as hunters.
Kromare, a senior Kayapo, though not a chief, has been designated leader of the hunt. Kromare is looking for animal tracks away from the main camp.
For the Kayapo, the forest is not merely a source of game animals or edible fruits. It is a world infinitely rich in meanings, where every plant or creature may have a specific use in magic or medicine, ritual or bodily decoration.
Unlike many Amazonian peoples, the Kayapo don't believe in a divine being, nor do they use drugs or alcohol. Even their magic must have practical purposes. Kromare has noted that the bees are fat, so logically, if he rubs them on his hunting dog, it will bring back fat game. Back at the hunting camp, it's early evening, and returning hunters announce from the forest they have taken important game.
Land tortoises are the main prey on this ceremonial hunt. They are the only species of game capable of being stored alive for the month or so that people are in the forest. Then they will be killed at a great feast back in the village, organized to christen a young child with a beautiful name. Pekan, the father of the child being named, acts as the focus for all the intensive hunting activity. The tortoises, as they are brought in, are tied in racks, still alive, and displayed in front of his shelter. Every Kayapo has common names, but only some receive beautiful names. For the child to receive beautiful status, the whole village must participate in the months-long ceremony and hunt. The beauty of the name given by the ceremony is the essence of the Kayapo idea of wealth. This wealth becomes a permanent part of a person's identity. It can't be bought or sold, like our money or commodities. Beauty, in this sense, is one of the highest values of Kayapo society.
Ka pran kram tin ane pram ko me kram tin ka me kram tin ane me humo anyu te ku ning ku te kren ga ji
In the center of the hunting camp is the men's hut. And as in the village, the men's hut is the center of Kayapo public activity. Each men's age group has its separate sitting place within it. And it's here that the system of respect can be most clearly seen, with the bachelors listening deferentially as senior men strut and orate before them.
Fueled by the controversy about gold, Cromari begins an oration to the assembled bachelors on the meaning of the naming ceremony. Next morning, the village is on the move again to a new campsite a mile away, deeper in the forest. Ropeni sings to scare away wild animals from the caravan. It took just 1 hour to abandon the old camp. It takes just 1 hour for the women working as a team to construct another.
Yeah.
It's now 3 weeks on. In the near deserted home village of Capote, an ancient warrior, Mayuri, signals with his lone dance, the hunting party is ready to return. Fires are lit to prepare food, and during the night, Pekan has come up river to supervise the festivities which will lead to the naming of his child. After 5 weeks away from the village, the exhausted hunters are back, now laden with 13 precious racks of tortoises from the forest.
High-pitched wailing or keening from the women greets the young bachelors as they perform their last duty of hauling the 200-pound racks of tortoises into the village circle. Keening is for women what oratory is for men, a stylized form of speech performed by senior women on important occasions like the return of the hunting party. Kromare, as leader of the expedition, ends the hunt by delivering a special chant called Ben. Ben resembles a more stylized form of the senior men's oratory and is normally reserved for chiefs alone.
The hunting party divides. The tortoises are taken to Pekan's house, where he and his family will start the great task of preparing them for the rest of the village. Meanwhile, the older men, the hunters, retire to the men's house in the center of the village.
The layout of the traditional Kayapo village of Capote is similar to that of the hunting camp. The men's house, called Nga, the word for center, is in the center of the plaza where the ceremonies are held, with the family households of the women and their husbands around the circumference. The political order of relations among the age groups and the performance of public ceremony have their focus in the men's house. A boy at the age of 8 is removed from his family house around the edge of the circle and goes to live in the men's house, which functions like a boarding school. Here, youths and bachelors learn to behave as a group in relation to the more senior men's and women's age sets. In practice, this means the married men who reside in the households on the edge of the village circle and who use the men's house as a kind of club. When a youth gets a girl he is courting pregnant, he moves up from the bachelor's age group to the group of senior men, and also moves out of the men's house to take up residence with his wife in her parents' house on the edge of the circle.
Baka A is Kromari's son-in-law. He now lives in Kromari's family house. He explains what happened when he first courted Koko Ja, one of Kromari's daughters, some years ago.
I'm going to go to the house.
Then Baka A moved in with Kokoja into her father's house. Kromari's house contains 28 members of his near kin, his extended family. Kromari's own immediate family, that of his wife's sister, and the families of his two daughters and sons-in-law. Here, Baka A has to obey his new parents-in-law just as he obeys the seniors in the men's house. Gold is on Ropni's mind when he begins a fierce oration to the boys and bachelors in the men's house on the true meaning of the naming ceremony, which is about to begin.
The men dance out of the men's house in the first of the climactic rites of the ceremony. These will culminate in the great tortoise feast and the giving of beautiful names to Pekan's child a few days later. The separation of the age groups is now overcome in the continuous line of dancers. The structure of ceremony thus draws together the groups divided in the men's house structure. This unity creates for the Kayapo the beauty that is passed on to the child by the ceremony.
The dancing will go on for 5 days. Hearing that we must depart for the gold-rich village of Goritiri, Ropni, because he cannot write, asked to send a message on our tape recorder, criticizing the Goritiri leaders. Another group of 700 Kayapo Indians live in the village of Goritiri in the Goritiri Reserve. From the gold mine they control 10 miles away, Goritiri has an income of $2 million a year. At its airstrip, the two village chiefs fly in from Brasilia, the nation's capital. In the first plane is the senior chief, Kanyonk. Totoe, the other chief, flies in a second plane. There are two other family members in the party who are equally important. Tapiet, a nephew of one of the chiefs, and Kubani, son of the other. Schooled in Brazilian ways, they've enabled Goritiri to deal with the gold mine and the banking system. In effect, these two have become the first Kayapo technocrats. Chief Canyonk has been in Brasilia trying to see the president of Brazil. Goretiri has a serious problem. There are rumors that the government want to build a hydroelectric scheme that could flood huge areas of Caiapó land.
Pine Crow, Chief Totoi's wife, keening in the customary Caiapó greeting over Kuben I, her returning son. The wailing expresses the sadness she felt while he was away. The new brick houses of Gorotire, built along their Brazilian-style street, together with the men's house made of corrugated iron at the head of the street, exemplify the changes brought by gold and timber wealth.
When Totoi, the second chief, arrives, a meeting is called for the whole village in the men's house at the end of the street. Gold has brought dramatic changes here. Youths and bachelors no longer sleep in the men's house, but live with their parents instead. Word has got around that Chief Ropeni has sent a message criticizing the Goretiri people. The whole village, including the women, crowd into the men's house to listen to Ropeni's words. Chief Canyonk and his people are angry.
A general debate over relations with the Brazilians and the changes these might bring to their own society is raging among the Gorotire and other Caiapó. This degree of self-awareness about their own culture is in itself a great change in Caiapó history. Central to the debate is what to do about the huge gold mine at Maria Bonita on Caiapó land 10 miles from Gorotire.
The Caiapó were presented with a fait accompli when in 1982 gold was found and 3,000 tough and determined Brazilians invaded.
Que te dê segurança, senão cê dança, senão cê dança.
Maria Bonita has become a Wild West frontier post hacked from the jungle. The only way in is by light planes which land on the main street of the town. The Caiapó have managed to keep control of the mine by force of arms, laying down three rules for the miners. No guns, no women, and no alcohol. And today, only four Caiapó warriors run the site. This is Irio, their leader, son-in-law of one of the Goretiri chiefs. Irio makes up the third of the three Caiapó technocrats who run the gold business. Before a miner is paid by the treasury, he presents himself to Irio, and a percentage of the gold he scratched from the soil is taken by the Caiapó.
Como? 1909.
This is the Brazilian government treasury at the mine. Initially, they offered the Caiapó a tiny percentage of the gold from the mine, but when production quickly rose to $40 million a year, the Caiapó decided to take a 5% share by force.
Some 200 Caiapó warriors seized control of the Maria Bonita mine in April 1985. They did it by occupying the airstrip, the only means of access to the site.
42 e 7 décimos.
Decorated in traditional battle paint and feathers, and armed with war clubs, rifles, and bows and arrows, they cowed the 3,000 miners on the site by this calculated exhibition of savagery. The miners offered no resistance. Now that they are in firm control, the Kayapo successfully police the mine at its shops and inspect the baggage of all departing miners for smuggled gold, with only four warriors armed with war clubs. All of this represents a conscious use by the Kayapo of their reputation among the local Brazilians as savage killers.
The success of the Kayapo in seizing and running the mines is a remarkable achievement for an Amazonian Indian people. It is, however, a success which could raise impossible problems ahead. How will the newfound wealth affect Kayapo society and values? And how will they control the miners who've gained a foothold on their territory? As always, the Kayapo's main concern is for their land, and the answer they have come up with is straightforward and simple, if perhaps optimistic. Irio returns from the mine to his village of Goritiri. Irio is back because a beautiful naming ceremony is taking place in Goritiri. The ceremony is called the Kokô, and again as in Capote, the whole village must participate. Also getting ready for the ceremony are the two other young technocrats, Tapiet, who runs the banking system, nephew of one of the chiefs, and Kubani, who runs the government post here, son of the other chief.
Minha esposa está preparada, pintura, para me pintar. Eu vou tirar a minha roupa, ela vai me pintar. Sempre que eu ando na cidade, que eu uso a roupa, eu estou usando. Mas eu volto para minha aldeia, eu tiro a roupa, aí eu fiquei assim, como era antigamente.
Há muito tempo, desde 1975, que eu saí, era um jovem de 12 anos para a cidade conhecer a vida nova, como devem servir a vida dos brancos, né, a administração dos brancos, as contas de matemática dos brancos.
Mas ninguém não vai esquecer a cultura. Porque os índios Kayapó podem sair desde criança, podem criar fora e volta para a aldeia e pode usar a cultura.
Com os índios, para o governo possa, prometeu dar 10% para nessa comunidade Goroteira, mas não foi cumprido o que prometeu para os comunidades, 10%. Enquanto bota 10%, bota 0,1 para a comunidade. Então seria enganos, coitado, ele não conhece, não sabe as contas.
É, nós vamos fechar o garimpo daqui para 2 anos. O garimpeiro não vai trabalhar mais na nossa área.
Os índios não vão ter vontade de sair, não?
Não. Quem era dono, o dono que mandou para sair, foi sair. Quem era dono da terra é nós.
Os Kayapó não conhecem cachaça, não dança, não bebe bebida alcoólica, mas hoje, próprios brancos prometeu para o jovem beber bebida alcoólica.
Ele também não é nenhum, não é nenhum, não é nenhum.
É, antigamente era nossos bisavô que serviam na nossa própria festa, que representa animal.
The cocoa naming ceremony will go on day and night in the village for nearly 3 months. As in Capote, before a beautiful name can be given to a young child, the whole community must take part in the ritual. The ceremony consists of a series of masked dancers involving two anteaters, a male and a female. The male circles the female, courting her, and guarding against enemies such as monkeys. The monkeys alternatively escort and harass the anteaters, who in turn are watched over by the mysterious Coco masks.
During the 3-month-long ceremony, 3 children from Gurutiri will gain beautiful names. Every morning and every evening during the ritual, the children are protected and shelter under the Coco masks.
The Coco masks have the faces of catfish, but also the presence of human ghosts. They are worn by the ceremonial friends or godkin of the child being named. Their role is to guard the child during important ritual transitions like the receiving of a ceremonial name. Each morning and each evening, the Coco masks are slowly escorted back to their resting places in the houses of the children who will be named. Parents of the name-receiving children don't take part in the celebrations. Instead, they must work to feed the dancers twice a day for up to 3 months, a heavy obligation in a community of 700 people. Dancers sit in the men's house divided into their age groups of bachelors, young married men, and seniors, calling impatiently for food.
Branca and Maiku are the parents of one of the children receiving a beautiful name. Gold revenue comes into the community in other ways. The Gurutiri chiefs have bought themselves into the 20th century by purchasing a light aircraft and hiring a Brazilian pilot. With the plane in use to patrol their land, the Kayapo have become the first Amazonian tribe to have an air force. Today, Tapayet is on a routine flight searching for squatters on Kayapo land. Gurutiri land is about the size of an average English county. 4 vigilante posts used by teams of armed Kayapo warriors have been set up to frighten off invading settlers. The Kayapo employ these Brazilian workers, paid by the gold, to run the posts.
É, um tempo desse, inclusive um dia desse o Antônio da Fazenda, ele veio até aqui, Aí falou até com o Capitão Canhão que... Quer ajudar essa picada? Disse que tinha gente aí entrando aí atrás, né? Mas aí nunca mais ele veio, até que falou que quando fosse preciso ia precisar de um de dois para acompanhar, mas nunca mais falou, não sei também.
Another example of gold money finding its way into the community. Gorotiri village watching television. But this is no ordinary viewing. They're watching material shot on their own video camera.
Hey, mara may be okre, may be okre baye. Mara ami yo moya malika ji, me baye ami yo jare malika ji ne ba me ba yo alu ko benyo me kanu ni pejo. Alu ino mun kam alu bi mo kin ne kam ye. Me kanu ni pejo baye inyo moya o jare ni ko be ku te mali.
This is their own recording of a war dance performed by a neighboring Kayapo village. The chiefs perceive video as a way of storing Kayapo culture.
Damn it, man! Because may tabjo me, may kla me, tumra kute, may kano kumoi ne kute, may mali ra angkai.
Major Kayapo negotiations with Brazilians are also recorded. When a group of pilots tried to change their contract for flying planes to the mine, the discussion was played back to them afterwards.
The acquisition of aeroplanes and video cameras by the Kayapo is an ingenious use of their gold and timber revenues to protect their own culture.
When Tapayet led the war party of 200 Kayapo warriors to invade the mine and get back 5% of the gold, Gorotiri's own camera was there to record this important piece of Kayapo history. With the chiefs controlling the bank accounts, little, if any, real money circulates in Gorotiri. This can produce strange paradoxes. Beb Nora has a gold nugget he wants to sell. The traditional circular village plan has been abandoned at Gorotiri, but the changes appear to go much further than that. The new Brazilian-style houses tend to shelter single families rather than the old-style extended families. Only 35% of the houses at Gorotiri still contain sons-in-law living with their wives' parents, as compared with 85% at Capote. An even more striking change has occurred in the men's house at the head of the street. The young boys and bachelors no longer sleep there as they do at Capote. Instead, they live with their parents until they are ready to marry and set up their own households. Do these apparently interrelated changes represent a major breakdown of Kayapo society? Or, put differently, has the acquisition of gold and other wealth undermined the traditional order of Kayapo society? The answer of the Gorotiri themselves is no. The beautiful naming ceremonies, such as this one, the Kurukang'o, are celebrated, if anything, more vigorously than ever. And the age groups in the men's house continue to organize village activities. The Kurukang'o is unique in that both men's and women's age groups dance together. This is clear as each group dances in a series of concentric arcs. One major side effect of the gold mine is the pollution stretching 10 miles downriver to the village. This doesn't stop the children of Gorotiri from playing in the water, but it has forced the Kayapo to rely more on alternative fishing methods in outlying streams and ponds.
One such is the ancient Kayapo method, which they call the attack on the fish. In a pond away from the river, bundles of vines are beaten in the water to produce sap, which deprives the water of oxygen. After a time, the fish are forced to the surface. The actual beating is organized by age groups, with the bachelors and seniors working in separate teams.
While waiting for the fish, Kapran Poi, one of the fishermen, takes issue with charges that Gorotiri is abandoning its culture.
Vivid method of instilling the young bachelors of Goldrich Gorotiri with traditional age group values is the ordeal called the attack on the wasps. This is a dangerous and painful ritual in which youths of the bachelors' age group must plunge their fists into a wasp nest in a tree high above the ground. Under the unrelenting gaze of the senior men, the bachelors must demonstrate their discipline and aggressiveness by braving the stings and descending the scaffold before they are overcome by the pain.
Irio, the Kayapo leader at the mine.
Rites like this demonstrate the continuing vitality of the age group system of Gorotiri.
For a whole week, the chiefs have remained silent about their visit to Brasilia, the nation's capital. But rumors of the proposed hydroelectric dam are causing concern in the village. Chief Canyon calls for all the men to assemble in the men's house with their war clubs.
I'm
me babi ngu krebi te ngubi ka inyu. Ngu te me babi puka obi mnara ka me bai te bin kini, me bai mru bin kini kaju. Ka me babi ngu krebi baku ni ba ma ki ikir kumne. Mambi alu. Baye bine, baye obi obi kenyu ka me woyu bali pundu kume, ba baba ju bali pundu kiri kaju. Baru me, jeja ba me ibe ngu krebi, kwa ba ibe ngu krebi, apu iba baja li ba me. Ibenya jule iku ni aben kod me ka ben joka ye ka ben ya lenyu
Raiding other tribes or the Brazilians was until recently an important way that the Kayapo constructed their own identity. Now I sense that their recent successes in dealing with the Brazilians have had something of the same effect. You can feel their pride in themselves as they dance their traditional war dance. The women with their babies dancing among the men, extending their arms protectively above them, the fate of the whole society at stake. They danced this as they went out to seize the gold mine of Maria Bonita in 1985. I think they'll be dancing it again if the hydroelectric dams start going up on the Xingu River.